Hi, can someone mute them? Hi, this is Alicia and Stan from Google Play. I look after you. We've just got someone with lots of noise in the background that we're just trying to... There we go. It's a little bit more quiet now. Today we are delighted to welcome the fantastic Jasper Fforde to a Google Play Hangout on Air. Jasper is without doubt one of the most extraordinary writers alive today, I think. I think it's fair to compare him to Douglas Adams in terms of his imagination and ability to create the most extraordinarily believable world that shouldn't be believable at all. So thank you very much, Jasper, for joining us. How do you feel about publishing yet another Thursday Next? We're very excited that it's out now.
Oh, a bit of background noise
there. There is.
I can't talk over it. Oh, there are more people joining.
Right, we're just trying to... Hi, if you're not speaking, try muting your microphone, please. Because there's just a lot of background noise now, and we'd really like to be able to get this Hangout on Air started. Thank you, that's great. Jasper.
Right, okay, I'm here.
Thank you for coming.
Now you've gone...
Here we go. Perhaps you can just tell us a little bit about your latest Thursday Next book.
Right. Well, this is the seventh in the Thursday Next series, and really just picks up where we left from number six. But people who are perhaps not familiar with the series, it features my heroine Thursday Next, who lives in a parallel world, which is a bit like Britain, only more so is the way that I describe it. And she's a literary crime fighter. And it's really about her adventures, not just in her world, in this parallel Britain, but also in the book world, because she can actually travel inside books and actually interact with all the characters and situations and everything like that. So this one, The Woman Who Died a Lot, is her back in Swindon, just dealing with mostly, it seems, the problems of her teenagers.
I do have to ask, how on earth did you come up with a literary detective who could jump in and out of books? I mean, did a big light bulb go off one day?
It was a gradual thing. I spent nearly 11 years and about 6.5 books before I was published. So it was a gradual thing. I started off writing a couple of books with nursery rhyme characters as police procedurals. And from there, I thought, well, it's quite fun messing around and retelling nursery rhyme stories. And then I thought, well, it was a short hop from there to playing with characters in classical fiction. And that was the first book in the Thursday Next series, The Eyre Affair, in which Jane Eyre is kidnapped out of Jane Eyre, and someone has to get her back. And that someone was Thursday Next.
Fantastic. I'm just going to open the floor up now. Andreas, do you have a question for Jasper? Hi, Andreas, can you hear us? I think he might have frozen. We'll go to Nick. Are you there, Nick? Do you have a question for Jasper?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Excellent. Well, I do have a question, but it doesn't have to do particularly with The Woman Who Died a Lot. I'm halfway through this, by the way. It has more to do with what a writer thinks about in terms of how his work may be adapted into a different language. The question I actually posted in the comments a couple of days ago, well, have you, Mr. Fforde, ever caught yourself thinking, suck it, translators, there's no way you'll be able to translate this pun or this wordplay?
When I first wrote the books, I never even thought they'd be published in the US, let alone, you know, everywhere, seemingly, it seems, around the planet. In that, I was quite wrong. My books, I think, are published in about 18 different languages. It's very difficult for me to comment on the translations because I don't know how well they're translated. But I can comment on the German and French translations because my books sell very well in German and France. And they say that, yes, they do work. So I've spoken to people in Germany who have actually read them in English and then read them in German and say, yeah, it works totally. Because, of course, when you're a translator, you don't understand two languages. You actually understand two cultures. So if you're a very skilled translator, and there are a lot of extremely skilled translators out there, you know when a silly joke comes along that is, for instance, a bad pun, you know that you can't use the direct equivalent in the language you're translating into, but you can make up something that is kind of similar. And that's what the really good translators do. And a lot of them, I do speak to them now and again. I do get emails saying, you know, Jasper, you know, can you explain this plot point? Or can you do I get this joke right? And then they say how they're going to translate it. And I think a lot of translators look at my books not as a menace, actually, but a challenge, and actually really quite enjoy it.
Thank you.
Well, I can tell you one thing, that as a translator myself, I actually have nightmares about translating any of your books.
Yeah.
But thank you very much. It was very gracious of you to sign this for me. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Jake, do you have a question for Jasper?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Every time you start a new book in each series, how do you kind of make sure you stay within the rules that you've already created in the previous book?
I mean, it's interesting because I've basically got sort of three or maybe four series going, and all of them happen in subtly different worlds. At the moment, I seem to be able to keep it in my head. If I were to write a Last Dragon Slayer book, then I know pretty much how that functions. And then if I'm writing perhaps something from a Thursday Next book in the afternoon, then I can subtly, you know, switch over to how that world functions. At the moment, I seem to be able to keep it pretty much in my head. But when I write a book, I don't actually do that. I don't do one book in the morning, another book in the afternoon. That would be insane. I actually sort of place myself in that world, very much with this latest book, with The Woman Who Died a Lot. If I just put myself in Swindon and I looked around and I flicked through the books and looked at what was actually happening, and I said, right, well, this is happening, we've got all these different plot points, who's in power, who's the political party, is the stupidity surplus problem still on, and then I just exploited all these little sort of what was going on in the world. And in the same way, when I write the next book, which for me will be the last in the Dragon Slayer series, I'll just flick through the book, have a look at it. I'll probably reread at least The Song of the Quark Beast, so I know exactly what's going on. And then I'm in. So it's, I don't know how to explain it really, but I can actually shift between, it's like if you're having a conversation with your granny, right, you have a completely different conversation to one that you have with your best friend. Because all the rules and regulations and subtle uses of language are different. You know, you wouldn't use the same language that you use with your best friend with your granny. And you wouldn't even think that you're actually consciously changing between talking from your granny to your best friend. So it's kind of the same sort of thing, really, is that you just go, right, I'm in this book now, and this is how it works. And that's basically how I do it.
Thank you. Andreas, do you have a question for Jasper?
Yes. My question is about your home country, your place of origin, Wales. Wales is featured very differently in your books than normally. So it's a very cool place. So it's the one place that was able to shake off the shackles of the big corporations and so on. So my question is, how do you feel about Wales in reality?
In reality. I'm not actually Welsh, although I did hear there was someone told me there was a 14th century Welsh writer who said, and I should be able to say it in Welsh just to impress you, but I've forgotten what it is in Welsh. But what he said was, if you love Wales, you are Welsh, which I thought was really good. And since I do love Wales, then according to him, I'm actually officially Welsh. I live there. I have a Welsh wife. I have Welsh children, and I have a Welsh dog. So I think I'm kind of Welsh. I changed it into this Socialist Republic of Wales, really sort of quite late on in the day when I was writing a book, pretty much on a whim. And I kind of like the idea of alternative histories like this. And the interesting thing for me was actually when I do write about alternative histories, I like to actually go and have a look at the history and see if there was a jumping off place, because I think a lot of the history of the world is often on a knife edge, and suddenly you have something, there is a tipping point, and suddenly things go in a different direction. So I was reading about Wales and socialism and the this is getting a bit boring, but it's relevant to the story. And about trade unionism and the setting up of trade unions. And in fact, the South Wales coal mines was equal in the Midlands as to a very strong left-wing, you know, that's where a lot of left-wing socialist ideals came from. And the first socialist member of parliament we had in the UK was from Merthyr Tydfil, which is actually in Wales. But what was interesting about this is a history that I never learned in school in the UK as an English schoolboy. And also, it's like we never learnt any Irish history when we were at school. And this is remarkable, or maybe not so remarkable, by the fact that this has been omitted from our history. And it's very interesting that, you know, as a nation, we tend not to... The history is written by basically the victors. And if you were to write the history of Great Britain from a more socialist point of view, perhaps you'd include a bit more about Wales. But anyway, the way I decided to do it was that Lenin came for a meeting, and I think this is actually true. I think he came for a meeting or something in the East End of London in sort of 1906 or so, round about that sort of time. And the way I think about it is that he fell in love with a Welsh girl. And he moved to Merthyr Tydfil, and he undertook the Soviet experiment in Wales rather than Russia. So on the other side of the coin, in my book, Russia is still a monarchist state, and that's why the Crimean War, which also features in the book, managed to last for so long, because it never had the October Revolution. So although, you know, they're silly ideas, there is actually a sort of nugget of intelligence that lies behind them, and I always like to try and find a reason for why things are in my books, even if it's very, very tenuous.
There's a little bit of intelligence there, Jasper, quite a lot of intelligence in your books. They're a clever read.
Tiny little bit.
Grant, do you have a question for Jasper?
Yeah, as much as I've enjoyed the books, I really started to enjoy following Jasper on Instagram, and wanted to know if you'd talk about your photography a little bit.
Yeah, my photography. Well, look, I just happen to have this with me. Whether you can see that. This is actually a film camera. Now, film was a long strip of acetate that had a light sensitive... No, I'm kidding. I've been taking pictures for... Well, I built a darkroom when I was about 10 years old in the cupboard under the stairs at my parents' house. And it was, you know, go down to the local camera shop in those days and you can buy bottles of chemicals, which you probably, you know, would sort of kill you now. And I started processing my own film and taking pictures, and I'm still taking pictures 40 years later. And it's a bit obsessive, really, with me. But I still enjoy film for some strange reason. I feel there's that perhaps digital is too easy in this post-skill world. And when I take a picture that I really enjoy on digital, I don't seem to get the same sort of fulfillment with doing it on film, because film actually requires a little bit of skill, and I always think when you do something that has a little bit of skill attached to it as well, I don't know, I just think it's slightly more satisfying. I don't know why, I mean, it's silly, you can take brilliant pictures with digital cameras, and people do, it's just me, you know, I like a kind of retro thing. I have a 1918 Ford Model T as well, and my aeroplane was built in 1940, so you can see I'm not really totally up with new technology, although I'm using
it. Light.
Yeah, and I have one of these, like everyone does, and I love it. It's beautiful. But I also have one of these, actually, which I don't know whether anyone knows what this is. This is a Scion 5 MX, and that was huge technology in 1995, and I still have it. So it's a mix.
That's fantastic. Now, I hope I'm pronouncing your name right. John McHale, do you have a question for Jasper? I think we can't hear him right now. Let me just see if we can... Has anyone else got a question for Jasper? Jake, do you have a question for Jasper?
In each of the series, how much of the overall art do you have planned out? Because I know that Nothing will be a trilogy, but Thursday next year, that could just go on and on.
Okay, weirdly, Jake, you might have to turn off your phone because we're getting a reverb. If you've got another computer or phone next to you, that will interfere with the signal. That might be a good idea. Jasper, can you turn off that 1995 piece of technology for
me? Yeah, I saw this bit of rubbish. Yeah, that's gone. Have I frozen? No, I'm not. I'm right.
No, no, you're not frozen. Jake, are you ready for your question now? Yeah. Let's start again.
Okay. Of each series you've got on the go, how much of each one do you have planned out, like in full? Because obviously Shades of Grey, you said it will be a trilogy. Do you think like Thursday Next could just go and go, or is that like finite?
Yeah, I mean, I kind of pretend that I have a plan sometimes, you know, when I'm really trying to impress people. I say, oh, yes, I've got the whole series, you know, mapped out. I haven't at all. I have vague ideas where it's going to go, where it's going to head, but I tend to write best what I call on the hoof, and I literally will start writing and see what happens. With the Shades of Grey book, my Shades of Grey, not the other Shades of Grey, my Shades of Grey, which we're calling 49 fewer Shades of Grey, not 49 less Shades of Grey, 49 fewer Shades of Grey. I had a sort of vague idea where it was going, but I just really started writing, and then it's as fun for me, hopefully, as it is for people reading the books. If you're reading a Jasper Fforde book and you have no idea how it's going to turn out, you know, neither did I. I just started it and, you know, tried to figure out where it was going to go as I was writing it. I write a bit by what I call narrative dares, which is something I've done ever since I was writing, when I first started writing back in 1988, when I was doing mostly short stories. And a narrative dare is just sort of me giving myself a dare to write my way out of. For instance, in The Eyre Affair, it was Jane Eyre has been kidnapped and somebody has to get her back. And that's a narrative dare. And you go, right, well, how am I going to deal with that? And then I'd have to create a world in which this could actually happen, and then someone to get her back, Thursday, and someone who did it, Acheron Hades, and everything starts popping into place. And then I just add more and more, pepper it with more and more detail here and there until I kind of like it and my publishers tear it out of my hands. And that's what I do. So I don't really have too much of a plan. But because I know that I don't have a plan, I use what's called my no plan plan, which is a very sneaky little thing. So I leave little what I call off-ramps for myself, on-ramps and off-ramps, which are little plots, plot ideas that I sort of introduce and then don't follow through. And then a book later or two books later, I'll go, okay, now I'm going to use this one now. And of course, then it's kind of familiar in the reader's mind, and it doesn't seem as though it's come from left field. So although, you know, I make it up as I go along, I actually have a plan whereby I can actually, you know, exploit the fact that I don't know what I'm doing. You know, it's called a sort of, you know, glorious ignorance or something like that. But yeah, the no plan plan is basically how I write. But you asked also about Thursday Next and Thursday series. Yeah, that's a series that can run. Because there's nothing I can't think of that can't fit somehow into Thursday's world. Because if you imagine, there's Thursday's world, and then when she's in the book world, it's a world within a world, and then when she goes into a book in the book world, it's a world within a world within a world. And each of them has subtly different rules and regulations. So if I wanted Thursday to do something bizarre and unusual that can't fit into the two, you know, the book world or her world, I'll just put her in a book in which that can work. And I'm writing books about books and books about storytelling, and because there's a huge array of stuff I could talk about, I don't think there is... I think it's a canvas without edges, if you can imagine that, you know. A flat plane, a flat plane canvas without edges. It would just go on and on. I could just pick one subject from a Thursday Next book, and then I could exploit that, I think, almost into a full-length book. So I think, yes, the Thursday will run and run, just not every single year. I'll just do some other stuff and come back to Thursday.
Thanks, Jasper. Yes. I've got a question here from Han, who wants me to ask it for him. How long is there between First Among Sequels and One of Our Thursdays is Missing? The Speedy Muffler situation seems to be about the same position.
Let's think now. First Among Sequels and I'm not sure. You can usually figure it out by the age of their children. By the age of Thursday's children. and I think there must be maybe 2 or 3 years. And the Speedy Muffler thing, or in the racy novel genre, the Axis of Unreadable, as it's called. Yes, there's a topical gag now, isn't it? Yeah, I think that one's been, you know, going on for a while, and they have been actually, you know, sort of trying to keep a lid on the whole racy novel thing, and it kind of sort of exploded in their face. Yeah, actually, it is very topical, really, isn't it? I haven't really thought of that. Yeah, Speedy Muffler is clearly behind the whole Fifty Shades of Grey thing. But whether there's any metaphor, you know, in the book or not, well, I don't know. I haven't read it, but we'll see.
Maybe Thursday next could go and tie up Christian Grey.
Well, Louise, the fact that you know there is a character in the... I'm assuming there is a character called Christian Grey in this book, but I have no idea. But if you say there's a character called Christian Grey in Fifty Shades of Grey, Louise, we'll take your word for it.
Okay, we're going to go to John McKell again and see if he's got some sound. John, have you got a question for Jasper?
Yes, can you hear me this time?
Yes, we can.
Yeah. And actually, the person who... asked a question right after me, actually asked the question I was going to ask. So I have a new question, and that would be maybe Thursday next. Such a great name. Was there any, how did you come up with that or what? I love that name for a strong female character in your books. Yeah. I just think it's fantastic.
Okay, Jasper, turn off your phone.
Oh, what?
Can everyone turn off their phones, please?
Oh, phones.
That's better. We're good. Go again, Jasper. Okay. Sorry, there's a good reverb.
Right, so, yeah, what I do is I actually have a list of names, which I actually write down. And when I see something, I go, oh, that would make a brilliant name. And Thursday Next was actually a name on my list for a number of years, because my mother used to say, or still does say, Thursday Next instead of Next Thursday. And I, when you hear something that you go, ooh, that could be a name, you know, it's like Bowden Cable or Landon Park Lane or Speedy Muffler even, they just sound like they could be really, really good names. So I heard Thursday Next, and it's also, if you listen to it, it has a little internal rhythm to it. It has a dum-de-dum, Thursday Next, dum-de-dum, which there's a lot of rhythm that runs through writing when you... If you read it back to yourself, you can actually put a rhythm into things, and if you can, they just read that much better. Anyway, so it was on the list, and when I just finished writing The Fourth Bear, which is probably about 93, 94, they were my first two books I wrote, I was thinking, I had that narrative dare, as I was talking about earlier, and I said, right, okay, Jane Eyre is kidnapped from Jane Eyre, someone has to get her back. Female protagonist, because I had a male protagonist for the last two books, and I looked down the list, and there she was, Thursday Next, and I went, perfect. It's enigmatic, it's an impossible name, but it's kind of just, maybe it is possible, and it just seemed absolutely right for her, so I used it, and it seems to have worked out quite well. Although it was slightly daring, I thought, when I was writing the book, I thought, you know, would anyone buy a book with a protagonist called Thursday Next, and actually the answer is yes. Rather delightfully. So that was really how it came about, and I still have this list, and it has names on it like Milton Towles, you know, Robert Kitchen and stuff like that. So just silly names, you know, that I hear and I like. Decoy Duck, that was another one. I saw a Decoy Duck, and I thought a Decoy Duck, like DeForest Kelly, Decoy Duck. You know, it sounded like a good name.
Okay, we've got about 5 minutes to go. Does anyone else have another question for
Jeff? Yes.
Andreas?
Yes, speaking of Shades of Grey, I'd like to know how you came up with the idea to make such a visual book, because visuals are really a strong theme in this book, of course. So does this have anything to do with your with filming, or how did you come up with concentrating so strongly on the visual intake of a person?
Yeah, I mean, I tend to think of books. People always say that radio is the best sort of visual, you know, media, because you have to make up all the pictures yourself. But I think books actually could come into that. You do make up all the pictures yourself when you're reading a book. The narrative dare, if you like, with Shades of Grey. I've always been fascinated by the notion of visual colour, because although, I mean, you can see my shirt is actually red, it's not really red at all. You've made it red inside your head. There is no red in real life. There is no color in real life at all. It's simply how we clothe the world to make sense of it. And it makes sense to us to be able to see things as different colors. And it's a wonderful abstract concept. If you were to try and say to yourself, well, what is red? You could say, well, that's red. The tomato's red. And you go, yes, I know, but what is it actually? And you go, well, it's actually a sensation in your head, and it's really fairly indefinable. And the narrative dare here was to actually take this notion of visual color that I think we take for granted a lot of the time, and just to put it center stage and make a society, construct a society around it where everything is dominated by this notion of visual color. It's interesting you asked the question about working in the film industry, because I'm not really sure how much of a I've always loved story, and that's why I went to work in the film industry. But I'm not sure about the influence, because when you make a movie, you actually make it in not reverse order. You just chop it up into bits, and you film it in a very strange order. You don't start at the beginning and finish at the end. You'll do scene 47 first, then you'll do scene 23, and then you'll do a bit of scene 57. You know, you might do the reverse of 57. You know, another week after that. So it's very disjointed, but. I think the influence of movies is the fact that I worked for 20 years in an industry with a lot of very, very unusual people in a lot of very interesting locations all the way around the world. And travel and talking to other people, of course, is hugely beneficial. So I think the influence of the film industry was really from me working in it rather than actually the storytelling sort of ideas within it. Although, of course, I'm influenced by those because I watch movies and I love movies, and they've always been my first love. I'm not sure really whether it's influenced or not. It's impossible to say really, because I'd have to have my life again and then not be in the film industry and see if my my books are the same. But of course, they wouldn't be, because when you're an author, you're the sum of all your experiences. You know, the sum of all the things that you've ever done. It's just part of me and part of the books, I guess. Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Jasper. We're going to have to tie up here. We've got one more. We've got a couple of minutes for one very short question, if anyone else has one. Are we good? Okay.
Traveling. A question about traveling. How much do you like to travel, and where do you like to travel most?
I've been to quite a few places, but I guess I haven't really. I like to go to new places. The great thing about travel when you're working in the film industry is you go there to work, but you don't take the whole crew. So you pick up local crew, which means that you actually get to work with people from foreign countries. Now, that's very different from being a tourist, very different. And the sort of travel I do now is kind of really sort of, well, to sort of do signings and bookshops and stuff like that, which kind of isn't the same. And if I was traveling as a tourist, I wouldn't really feel that I was getting the same sort of experience. It was very, very interesting to work with people, because really, really to know how similar we all are, actually, to be honest. Where I'd like to go now? Well, where haven't I been that I'd really like to go? I haven't been to India ever, even the entire sort of Indian subcontinent. Never been there. Was never taken there. And I'd really like to go, I must say, for the sights and the smells and the sounds and everything. But Istanbul, I really want to go to Istanbul, never been there. I want to go to Athens to see the new museum that's been built up there. So, the list is very big. But when I do travel, I don't like to do it as a tourist. I like to try and meet someone there, and then they can actually show us around. And that is quite good about being an author rather than a tourist, is that the people that you meet who work there, you can actually say, right, tell me about this. What's it like? Show me around and talk to me about what it's like to be living here. So I do like to travel, but I don't do so much these days, really. Yeah, sadly.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you so much for your time today, Jasper. It has been a real pleasure to have you here in this Google Play Presents Google Hangout on Air. That's a mouthful. And hopefully we might see a hangout in one of your new books. Thank you, everyone else, for coming along. And we'll see you again soon. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Brilliant. Thank you, everybody. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.